Can't read Japanese very well, but I think I did this correctly. That was a lot easier than I thought. It's my last night here in Tokyo today. We're leaving back to LA tomorrow. Not sure what I'm gonna get myself into today, but I am out of underwear.
This place is pretty cool. They have washer dryer combos, and although it's not very cheap, if you just wanna set it and forget it and come back in an hour, your clothes will be done.
I didn't know that, so I'm just gonna wait like 15 minutes and then put my clothes in the dryer.
Very nice day today in Shibuya. Maybe like a cloud. Dude, it's so pretty. I like this rainbow shade.
It's us. Oh, there's a quick time event.
Oh, we're number two. I'm here with my friend B. We're gonna try the world's largest conveyor belt sushi restaurant here in Asakusa next to the Sky Tree. I think I'm gonna eat at least 20 plates.
20? 10.
I'm gonna try 20.
I'm gonna eat 5 ika because I love squid, I love octopus. This is my ultra favorite.
That one?
You want one?
There's two levels. The ones that we ordered are gonna come here, and then you can just get the like service ones that are communal. It looks good.
A little bit.
She ordered this, whatever this is. That one's not good.
Really?
Cheers.
Gyoza with ice cream, dessert time. 2, 4, 6, 8, 26, 28, 30.
Damn. Nice job. Do you have free food?
Which one do I choose? This one.
Oh, we lost?
Oh,
shit.
Oh!
Oh, wait. It changed. Oh, damn! Pocket aces!
Alright, so after eating, we can play this game. It's like a shooting game, I guess.
Are you supposed to shoot, like, specific things?
Oh.
Oh my god.
Shoot it all. Come on, faster finger. Fuck him up.
Oh my god.
None of them are dying.
Chemical.
Oh, one of them died. Kill him.
What'd you get?
I don't need this.
There's another game.
Oh, what do you have to do?
Yeah. Is this a game?
Yeah, I think it's a game. Just
watch it.
Oh, we got two.
Yo. Well, that's cute.
That's cute.
I don't think I would come all the way out here for that again. I would rather go to Sushiro.
Yeah,
or
like come on.
Yeah, but it was cool. The biggest in the world. So I've been to Japan many times, and as a foreigner, I'll admit it's actually very difficult
to navigate and use things around here, especially if you don't speak the language and if it's your first time. I want to share a couple of things that I've done for this trip that might help you if you travel to Japan in the future. Japan's internet infrastructure is very advanced, and if you're coming here and you need internet, there are many different options that you can do. You can rent Wi-Fi wireless hotspots, you can get SIM cards at the airport, and you can even get this thing that I just found out about, which is the Wi-Fi box. There are many places where you can actually find these and rent these. They have kiosks scattered throughout Japan, especially at the airport or anything like that. This particular one I picked up here at the Shibuya Fukura's building. You can find it right here, the Shibuya San Tourist Information Center. Here's the Wi-Fi box kiosk actually right here. It's very simple. All you have to do is go to the website and book and register one. It only takes a couple minutes. Just select what day and where you want to pick it up. There's also three options you can get for data rates. I picked unlimited and also where you want to pick it up. The one here in Shibuya is the Fukura's building first floor, and add it to cart. After you get it and you decide you want to have it for a little bit longer, you can even extend it through the website. After you make the payment, you can just press pick up and your camera will activate, so you can scan the code right here and just press the pick up button, and one of these should just pop out. There it is. Now you got your new Wi-Fi box. The SSID and the password are just on the back, so pretty simple. The other thing that I like about this is that it can also act as a battery. It has USB-C, iPhone charger, and USB micro. When you're done, just simply return it by just putting it in like that, and it's it. This place will even store your luggage here.
Another thing, Japan typically doesn't have public trash cans, so if you happen to find one, keep that in mind. When you ultimately have trash that you want to throw away, you'll know where to go. Rarely they'll be in a station. Sometimes you'll be able to throw them away at like a fast food or convenience store. I found one here at this bookstore. Toss it out. My next tip is to try to get one of these guys. These are IC cards, and there are a few different versions. There's like the Suica, Passmo, Welcome Suica, and things like that. Basically, what these allow you to do is they can pay for pretty much any transportation, and also you can use them at some stores and vending machines. This is a very good alternative than to getting train tickets and subway tickets, because when you do those, you have to kind of calculate the distance. These will just calculate it for you. You just top them up using cash. Very simple to use, and it'll save you a lot of time and money trying to figure out how to navigate the system. I know currently at this time, they're actually not making these anymore here when this video is made in 2023 due to a chip shortage. But if you have an iPhone, you can download the Suica app and you can use your phone to tap into the turnstiles instead. As I was shooting that, there's like a foreign couple right there who's asking them how they could get the card too. Coincidentally. Fortunately, you can't buy them anymore, but hopefully they have the app. Back here at Haneda Airport, one of my favorite airports I have ever been to. My last tip to you guys is about airports and airfare. This trip, I was able to get it for under $600. And the way I did that was that I used Google Flight Tracking. So you can create an alert for kind of like the date range and the airports that you want to go to. I followed this for maybe about like 3 months until I finally got a price that it'll alert you if the price goes down or goes up. My threshold was kind of like I wanted to be sub $700. I ended up finding a flight for about $680, I think, is what I paid for in the end. It'll even show you kind of the trend of how it will go. I know there are other services that offer kind of flight hacks, but I don't really use any of those. That's the only one I really use for this particular flight. The other tip I wanted to give is that Tokyo has two main international airports, Haneda Airport and Narita Airport. I highly recommend going to the Haneda Airport instead of the Narita one, if possible. I mean, get the cheaper one, but the Haneda Airport, I think, is a lot better. It's more efficient, way less people. It's closer to the main Tokyo area, so transportation is gonna be a lot easier. And also, there's really good food here. It looks really cool. There's a observation deck on the other side, and if you really wanted, like I did in my episode about coming to Japan, also they have an onsen when you arrive, so you can, you know, take a bath if you have some time. Anyways, Haneda Airport is really cool. Now we gotta head to the gate so I can board my flight. TSA check-in, let's go.
It's super easy to get through the TSA here. Okay, maybe I shouldn't say this, but all I really had to do was just put all my bags and stuff in my pockets in the little bin, and then it goes through the x-ray. No taking off my hat, no pulling out the laptop or any of my batteries or anything like that. It's super comfortable. I'm not sure if I'm allowed to say that or not.
Waiting for my flight back to Los Angeles. I had to get a couple more of these. Japan, and especially Tokyo, is like very difficult for foreigners to come, because I think the infrastructure is very complicated, especially if you don't know Japanese. And honestly, for me, as a foreigner here too, I oftentimes feel lonely when I come to Tokyo. My tip to you guys is to either really learn the language or find friends. I think Japanese friends could really help out. I think once you're actually here, it's a little bit tricky to like find friends once you're here. So if you can have friends before you come to Japan, that'd be a lot better. But hopefully if you can get here and maybe make friends, you'll have a much better time here in Japan.
Made it back to the US. There's one more thing that I want to share with you guys, and if you're coming back to America via LAX, at least there's a very quick and easy way to get past customs that I feel like not many people know about, and I kind of want to gatekeep it to keep that line short. But it's called the mobile passport control app, or MPC, and basically what it allows you to do is to get into a specific line, and all you really have to do is answer a questionnaire really quick and show the person your passport. The line for this is much shorter than the regular customs re-entry, and it gets much faster to get past that customs control. Anyways, MPC app.
The citizen border patrol entry is on that side. This is the mobile passport control app.
Good to be back home. Woo.
I wish I had a hack to get out of LAX easier and faster, but it's one of the worst airports.
Finally, after a 14-hour flight, back home here in LA.
I think with that, it concludes our trip to Japan and Korea 2024. I hope you guys enjoyed the vlogs and the little tips that I gave. I think right now is a good chance to show you guys the things that I brought with me to Asia this year. With me, I brought this bag. This is the Good Bags Road 2.0. And I really like this bag because it carries not only my camera, but also has space in the back for a 13-inch laptop. They don't make these 13-inch laptops anymore, everything comes in 14, so I do believe that there is an upgraded version to this that fits like 14-inch MacBooks and whatnot, and you can't get this colorway anymore, this is the exclusive one. Inside my bag, I have this charger. This is the 65-watt-hour GAN charger by Geek Fully. The cool thing is that this has a little plug-in that you can use if you're using this in Japan. It works perfectly well. Even if you are outside and charging, let's say your phone, or you need to charge your laptop at a cafe or something like that, this will charge it the whole way. And it's 20,000 milliamp hours, which is pretty big. If you are gonna be using this in a country like Korea though, you'll need a converter. As for my camera, I am using this setup. This is the new Sony Alpha 6700, the newest APS-C camera that came out.
Together with it, I have the Sigma wide angle 10-18 f2.8 lens with the Peter McKinnon variable ND mist edition filter, as well as for the mic, the Sony ECM M1, which is the newest one that has the new capsule system, and you can choose which mic direction you want. Also, the PGY Tech Mantis Pod 2.0. I wanted this system specifically because I needed a camera that was very compact and didn't take a lot of space in my bag. Earlier this year, I was using the Sony FX30 for my vlog in spring, together with the Tamron 11-20 f2.8 and the Sony ECM B10. So this system is not a big system per se, but it's definitely a little bit heftier compared to this new one. So I really wanted to downgrade how much space and weight this was taking in my bag, because when you're outside vlogging the whole day, it does weigh on your shoulder kind of a bit. So pairing my lenses on the tight end for this combination, at that time I was using the Helios 4-4-2, which is my favorite lens. However, normally with the Tamrons, you'd be matching this with the Tamron 17-70. For this trip specifically, I was pairing the Sigma with the longer Sigma, the 18-50. This one kind of extends a little bit. Also with the KNF Nano X filter right here, because Polar Pro doesn't make a 55mm one, and I don't want to have a step-up ring. I just don't like step-up rings. So these lenses are, as you can see, obviously significantly smaller than the Tamron counterparts to them, which make them much more ideal for vlogging. I also supplemented this camera with my new upgrade, the DJI Action 4. I talked about this in a few videos ago, but I really like this camera because it has that wide-angle vlog type look. I also put the PGY Tech suction cup thing on it so that I can get very interesting camera angles. I could just plant this on like a sign or a window or something like that, and put a time lapse or anything. Also, vlogging on this is way easier than pulling out this guy if I want to be a little bit more inconspicuous or if I'm walking. The stabilization is actually really good. Microphone is good, and also this one has 10-bit, which I think is a big upgrade compared to the one I was using before, which is the DJI Action 2, which is also I really like because it's so small and you can just pretty much do whatever with this thing. So anyways, I hope you guys liked all the videos that came out for this vacation this year. I'm sorry, it's probably gonna take a while for me to edit all these videos. I know I'm pretty slow when it comes to that, but that is pretty much I have for the rest of the year. I might make one or two more vlogs, but starting in 2024, let's try to come out with some new interesting content, and I'll see if I can try to make something else happen in 2024. Anyways, I really appreciate you guys enjoying all my videos and hanging out for the adventure. More videos to come, and I'll see you guys soon.
Hello, so this is John SF. This last day in Japan.
Yeah.
Going home tomorrow.
Can't wait.
Yeah. Damn, this camera is so good. Well, wow. So what are your last words in Japan?
Later.
Later?
Fuck Japan.